If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 30 minutes, we have some fun conversation. We talk about if Justin
was peanut butter, would he be chunky or would he be smooth?
I think we know the answer to that.
I'm hybrid.
What kind of toothpaste
would
we
taste
use.
Delicious. I know that much.
We talk about how our childhood influences our purchases as adults.
Yeah, how much money have you wasted?
Find out why Adam has remote control cars in his shed. Yeah. And we talk about my visit to the Russian nude spa.
Spa, or is it a bathhouse?
Sounds sexy.
It was a good time.
Is it a brothel or was it a spa?
And it's co-ed. And we also mentioned Thrive Market, one of our sponsors. If you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump, you get $20 off the first three orders of $49 or more, plus free shipping and 1 month free membership. Basically, you get everything and you lose nothing. It's awesome.
Yeah.
And then we get to the questions. The first question was, what are our thoughts on active recovery days versus full rest days? Should you move? Does that make you recover faster? Or should you lay down in bed?
Lay down on your fat ass.
And watch TV all day long. The second question was, Olympic lifting shoes. Why are they so popular? Are they just are people just trying to lie themselves about their ankle mobility?
Or are you just trying to look cool?
Exactly. The next question was, what are our thoughts on sexual fitness? Luckily, we have Justin here, our local
Kegel, thousand
the
Kegel, thrusters.
The Kegel expert.
Our expert on sexual fitness. And he, unfortunately, you can't
I can
watch
hold a bowling ball.
His demonstrations, but he does show us, what's it called, jelking? And then the final question, if we had the choice of being on a reality TV show, which one would we choose?
Oh, God.
Yeah. Hey,
don't forget, too, I want to make sure that we thank our Organifi sponsorship, one of our favorite sponsors that we've had for quite some time now. Love Shauna, love Drew, love the team over there. If you guys have not tried their green juice, it's a must. Go try their green juice. It's at OrganifiShop.com. Use the discount code MINDPUMP and you get 20% off.
Awesome. And also, this month, of course, we have our fitness programs, but one of the ones that we like to highlight this month is our Sexy Athlete Bundle. This is a program or bundle that includes both MAPS Aesthetic and MAPS Performance, two programs that seemingly exist on separate ends of the spectrum. On one hand, you have one that focuses on looks. It's for stage presentation athletes, bodybuilders, bikini competitors. On the other end of the spectrum, we have MAPS Performance, which is for athletes. It's for people who just want to perform better on the field or who just like that functional type of strength. What we did is we took both programs, we included a modification and combined the two so that you can get the best of both worlds. You can perform like an athlete and look like a stage presentation athlete. And it depends on which one you prefer more. The mod lets you train more like an athlete or more like a bodybuilder or a bikini competitor. Combine the two, amazing results. It's the Sexy Athlete Bundle. It's available at mindpumpmedia.com.
Get it. T-shirt time.
Oh, who are we giving? Hey, how do we do on reviews this week, Doug?
11 reviews.
Okay, not too bad.
So terrible.
We're going to give out three shirts. First up is I Am Me, Madison Fit Girl, Trent Hart 22. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Congratulations.
Are you a chunky peanut butter or are you a smooth guy?
Yeah, I'm a smooth guy, bro.
Were you ever chunky? Don't lie either.
I mean, I did it out of necessity. Like, that was my only option.
If you were a peanut butter, you would have chunks in it, though. Like, if you...
Yeah, if, like, I embodied the peanut butter.
If we had a jar of
you would
Justin,
be smooth?
And I would be the one that, like, has all the oil at the top.
No, that's all natural. That's Sal. Shit. That's Sal.
That's me, bro.
That's Sal.
What do you say? I'm more like Jif?
You're kind of chunky,
come on,
dude.
Man, I'm not that process.
You'd be chunky Jif.
You're chunky Jif.
I'm smooth.
Adam would be the low-fat, high-protein one.
Like, I would have chocolate mixed in.
No, yeah, as I say, I'm the jam in the peanut butter mixed together.
I'd be, like, slightly hazelnut. Dude. You know,
it cracks me up that they actually sell peanut butter with jelly in it, like in the jars.
Dude,
this is how lazy motherfuckers are getting nowadays.
This is.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And you know what I saw the other day that apparently exists?
Well, it looks more organic that
way. Have you guys seen this? So maybe you probably haven't because you don't have kids. I know Justin has. They actually sell at the grocery store in the refrigerated section, made and packaged
Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches.
Peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Yeah,
yeah. Wait, wait. In that. Packages?
Like Smucker's makes a fucking sandwich. Man. It's in a plastic wrapper.
Dude, people love those.
You buy it people and it's love, made already.
People love those.
That's
the
easiest sandwich to make.
It's not even... It's not. It's what I'm saying. What's that's how lazy.
That doesn't
how
make sense.
That's how lazy the world.
How
has
artificial
gotten.
Is it?
Dude,
like,
remember
all fake?
You guys remember Goobers? Remember that? It was a
Goobers?
Mix.
Yes.
Yeah, it was a mix of peanut butter and then it was like jelly, like in the same can.
It looked. You know what it
and
looked
it was like?
Like?
There was like stripes.
Yes. You know what it looked like?
It was Goobers.
It looked like what's that toothpaste with stripes?
Oh yeah, Aquafresh.
It's like Aquafresh, but yeah. It's in a jar and it's peanut butter.
My girl's an Aqua. What are the peanut butter? What's the toothpaste relationship you guys have with your ladies?
What do you mean?
What do they use and what do you use?
Oh, we both use the same. Both use the Tom's fucking. You know,
I use the Tom's.
Yeah, baking soda and you know.
I use Crest, man. Yeah.
So I was a Crest guy my entire. So does your wife use Crest too?
She uses it too.
So Katrina and I don't share toothpaste.
Oh, really?
Yeah, not because like we wouldn't share. She just I don't like hers.
Icky.
She grew up on Aquafresh, and I do not like Aquafresh. It's like way overpowering, like flavor minty shit in your mouth. I don't like that.
Yeah.
I'm a Tom's guy.
Oh, there you go.
So we have wherever we go, like we have Tom's and we have Aquafresh. Good. Like and her tube like makes a mess, and she used to blame it on me all the time. Like you make the tube a mess. Da, da, da. I'm like, that's not me. It's your stupid Aquafresh. Like, look at my Tom's tube. Look how smooth and how nice it looks.
When I was a kid, all I wanted was Aquafresh, and I never got it. My mom never bought it because I think it's expensive. But I always wanted it because, yeah,
like 25 cents more.
That's such a sad story.
It's such a sad story. You know what that reminds me of? That reminds me of my story.
I brushed my teeth with a bristle made of horsehairs.
Yeah. Okay, so that reminds me of something.
I feel like you'd have a gold toothbrush.
How many things do you guys have as adults? I'll give you an example. Something that I do that's a little absurd. That I know stems from childhood, like that right there, right? So like maybe your mom wouldn't spend 25 more cents on a brand you want, so you overdo it with that brand. You have like 10 of them in your house. So I do this with air conditioning because we grew up poor and we can never run the AC. So
old people are crazy with that shit.
Oh, my dad would like literally as kids, he would come in and we'd get screamed at, dude. Like, who touched the thermostat? I set it at 72.5. It's at 71.5. I know one of you kids did it. You're all grounded. You know what I'm saying? Like that was like that was
regular. Cost us $15 more.
And I'm in my room like sweating my dick off, dude. Like literally. So as an adult.
Is that why you like it so fucking cold everywhere?
So you wonder why that is. That it stems from childhood. So I'll never forget the very first condo. I was 17 years old when I moved out in my first apartment. And it was awesome because it was an apartment. So getting it cold was easy. We kept that thing at like 49 degrees. You would come in the middle of
you
summer,
don't even need a refrigerator.
105 outside, walk in my condo and see your breath. Like that's how and I kept it that way all the time. And it was like, I don't know, I paid probably... In that little condo back then, back in the early 2000s, I think I was paying maybe $90 to $100 a month in air conditioning.
Who cares?
I was like, fuck that. Run that shit 24/7. Nobody, we would be gone for 2 days. Doesn't matter. That shit stays cold. Like,
yeah.
And I know that, like, I know someone's like, that's so wasteful. And that's but you know what? It comes from me as a kid and my dad fucking with me with the AC. So that's like one of my things. You guys have something like that?
I don't have anything like that because as much as I liked Aquafresh or I wanted Aquafresh, now I know all the bullshit that's in them, so I won't use it. But if I didn't, I probably would. I see what you're saying. I probably would buy Aquafresh toothpaste like crazy.
Well, dude.
Actually, it's not toothpaste. It's tooth gel. I'm sorry. Let me correct
I think
myself.
It's along those lines, it was like the hand-me-down stuff for me. Like I would ask for a snowboard or something like that for Christmas, and I would end up getting this like, like
your brother,
the very first
your
one
brother's
that was ever made,
your
like
brother's wrapped snowboard for Christmas.
Yeah. It's either that. Seriously though, I told you guys one time my parents gave me I wanted like a camera. They gave me like the old camera that like could only see green. You know, like it was fucked up. Like you could only see green out of it, you know, and like they never got it fixed. And so they like wrapped it up and gave it to me.
It was used?
Yeah.
They wrapped you up a used gift?
Oh, yeah. And like the snowboard too. It was like, it like faded away. It used to be red. So now it was like pink and like purple and like, you know, with like some shitty, like bright green color.
Did you ever get a gift as a kid where you remember kind of throwing a tantrum or being a little bitch about it? Like that you got it?
I was pissed.
Ungrateful. Do you ever remember being ungrateful for a gift?
I don't remember how old I was. When did the NES system first come out? The first Nintendo.
Very first Nintendo?
Yeah.
1987,
something like
not
that?
Not even that. I think it was
89, maybe. 89.
No. I like Justin's 87. I would guess 85 even.
Let me see. Let me look it up right now because I...
Doug used to do this for us. Taylor doesn't know how to do that yet.
Great.
Okay, it came out.
To our conversation.
Oh, 1985. Yeah. You're right, 1985.
Boom.
So this must have been... This was later, so I think this, because the NES dominated
you
for
a while.
You
see how I was right, and he just grazed right over that
you're
right there.
And then we're going to go into other
topics. If he was
topics,
right again on a Google search right there, we would have made a whole episode around
right,
it.
That's right, motherfucker!
He just grazed right over
it. Adam was right. Yeah. So I'll give that one to you.
Moving
right.
on.
Sold, save that. Yeah, yeah. So when it came out, it was like the shit for like 5 years. There was nobody
competing
with it.
What else did you have, Atari?
There was nothing.
Get out of here.
So I must have been like 9, which is later on. So it's probably 1987 or something like that. So I turned 9, and for my birthday, my parents got me like clothes or something like that. And I was like, fucking destroyed, because I wanted a Nintendo. And my parents were like, no, it's too expensive. Because it cost, back then, it was like $150 back in like 1987, which is a lot of money to spend on your kid.
Yeah.
Back then, nowadays, people spend thousands of dollars on their kids for gifts. Mm-hmm. When I was a kid, if my parents spent over $50, I was like, oh my God, I hope we can afford the mortgage. Like, that's how big of a deal I thought it was, right?
Right, right.
So I cried. I threw a fucking... I didn't throw a tantrum, because I wasn't that kind of a kid.
Yeah.
But I definitely... cried quietly.
Oh, I cried. Yeah. There was the time. My dad
took me. I will never forget. He saw me kind of turn around and whatever and then cry. And then they came and probed me like, what's the matter? Tell me what's wrong. And then I don't want to tell them because I don't want to be ungrateful. And they had to like pull it out of me. And I'm like, I really wanted a Nintendo. And then my mom's like, well, we told you it's too much money. And it's like, I know. I just thought you guys were going to get it for me, but you didn't. And I'm like, it's okay. I felt really bad for crying, right? So my dad, like, I hear him grab his keys and he goes, let's go. I'm like, what? And he goes, we're going to go get you a Nintendo. And I was like, yay. He drove me that second to the Toys R Us.
Oh, really?
And bought me a fucking Nintendo.
That's pretty cool.
And I was like, whoa. And then I realized, like, why have I not cried for more stuff? I can't believe how... Maybe that's why I was so powerful.
So my grandma was the one who got the nice gifts, right? So every Christmas, it was grandma's gift that we all were excited to open up because she spoiled all of us kids, right? My parents didn't quite have the funds to do that type of stuff. So if I ever got a Nintendo, a Game Boy, or anything like that... Well, I was really young here, so I'm like fourth grade, and I remember my buddy got one of those gas-powered remote control cars that, you know, that'll do like 60 miles an hour. Like, they are badass, right? Yeah. It's like a $300-$500 remote control car. So I put on my wish list, like, I wanted a remote control car. And I remember the box.
Like the D&J
ones. I remember the box, right?
They were so awesome.
My grandma, and I was certain she got it. Like, and so I opened it, and she saved it for last. Like, oh, it's this, you know, they always save the big gift for last, right, behind the tree. And I get it in its shape, just like, and I open it up, and it's a remote control car, but it's the one where the string is still attached to the car. It's like a $20.
It's a shit one.
Oh, it's shit. Yeah. Oh, dude, I was such a little shit.
Where you just, the way you turn is you back up and it automatically turns.
Dude, I was such a little shit. I remember just crying.
Ungrateful.
Oh, so ungrateful. I was angry. I remember being like angry. Like, why would you give me this? Like, I'm not 2. You know, it's like on the side of it. It says for 4 to 6 years old. Like, you know, I'm not 4 to 6 years old. I'm like 12. You know?
Oh my God.
I'm an adult right now. That's
dude, I got that. I remember Tyco ones? They were Tyco and they were fast. And they were pretty fucking quick. And I had Big Bubba, which was the truck. I don't know if you guys remember this. It was a truck with four wheel drive.
That name. Yeah.
Big Bubba. And then I don't remember what the other one was called. It was like a
Gravedigger
Turbo or something like that. It was like a little Doom buggy.
Oh, okay.
It went hella fast. Yeah. Those were good times, man.
You didn't have remote control cars?
I had like shitty ones always, and I was like, I was never like interested because I wanted the gas powered ones, like you're talking about.
I can't believe you guys weren't like me. Like, okay, so if you go through, this is really a sad story in a sense. So I have a garage or a storage in behind my house that's full of these things. They're all childhood issues that I had. Like, I have a fucking $700 fucking remote control car that's got all the bells and whistles.
Wait, you bought
a quad and you're living
as an adult?
Yeah. Oh yeah. 100%. And I drove the fuck out of it for like 2 weeks, and then now it's in some plastic case like up in the attic somewhere. I have a ton of stuff like this. Like,
so it's just the shit you want that you couldn't get.
Bro, what do you think my ATV represents? Like, that was like, as a kid, all I ever wanted was an ATV, and I knew that our parents could not afford a $7,000 fucking ATV. So I have one, and it looks like a coffee table inside my dining room. I haven't driven it in years, but I got it, dude, and it's badass. You know what I'm saying? So I have all kinds of like things like that. Wakeboards and snowboards and things that as a kid I always wanted and my friends had and I get to use or get to play with, but I never had. As an adult, I own them all and I don't fucking use them all.
I had a problem as a kid. This is what I did. Now, because I would work, you know, summers with my dad or whatever, I would have some money and I would buy this. Here's just what I used to do. I used to buy things and never use them as a kid. And you know what I would get closed on when I was a kid? Infomercials. I would 13, 14 years old, I'd watch an infomercial, and if it was a...
You bought Sea Monkeys?
The stupid stuff. It was always the dude...
I'll tell you what's... I know. Make consistency of Sea Monkeys. I'll make you some batch.
No problem. I would always fall for the get rich fucking programs on the infomercials. So when I...
As an adult?
No! When I was 14.
What?
13, 14, 15 years old. So I own Don LaPree's fucking... Get rich quick, tiny ads in all these newspapers. Just place your time. Basically, the beginning of sales funnels, but done through classified ads.
I got bamboozled one time, right? So you remember the whole like .com thing, right? So the .com was like valuable. They had all these like radio commercials and everything saying that like, oh, this is the new. Sort of like you could buy like a domain name and it's going to make you all this money.
Oh, shit,
right?
Yeah.
Because like if you own it, you know, and a company there's all these stories. Yeah, there's all these stories of these big companies that bought
back in the
domains and you parked it. And so they have to buy you for the domain. And so like this is further down the line. Everybody has all the good domains.
So what do you do?
Right?
You own like 50 domains?
I own like three. They're all like Star Wars domains. Like one of them was like StarWarsMemorabilia.com. And I was like, oh, that's going to be a hit right there. Like, oh, yeah, it makes so much money. Gold mine. You know what I mean? And I just kept going down this ridiculous like thought process. Like,
dude, did you
Rebel
buy?
Rebel Alliance, you know, .net. You know what I mean? It was like so bad, dude. I've spent so much shitty money on this. Oh, it was like hundreds of dollars.
You
fucking like
parked
in
all these domains.
Smacked myself in my face like thinking about it.
So I don't know how far you are in the .com secrets book, but Russell Brunson. So what inspired him to do what he does now today?
Yes, I know.
He used to buy and get. He used to anything that
Don LaPree. It's the same fucking course I bought, which is why it spurred my memory.
Okay, I was gonna say
because I bought Don LaPree's course. I bought Tom Vu. Do you guys remember Tom Vu?
I don't.
So he was that, like, he was a little Asian dude. He'd be on a yacht with, like, five taller than him, blonde, like, bimbo-looking women. And he'd be like, you want to be rich like me, Tom Vu? Look at me. Beautiful women. Big yacht. I make big money. I come to this country poor. And he
read like that Wolf of Wall Street.
And he had, like, these big gold chains.
Yeah.
And he would talk about how he made all this money by his course. You know, I used to eat baklao. Now he eats steak and potato. Like he would talk like that, like tell you all the things that he.
Oh, that's great.
And how he made all his money. He ended up going to jail because he was like ripping people off.
Oh, really?
But I bought his course. I bought Don LaPree's course. And I forgot. I think I bought another course. And I'd buy these courses and I'd open them and they'd be like, this is stupid. And then I'd never do them. And I have like, I got to find them. I know I have them somewhere.
Do you really? Wow.
I guarantee it.
I remember my parents going through all the real estate ones. When real estate was like booming and shit like that, everybody was making money off of real estate. They bought all those fucking $4,000, $5,000 courses online. Dude, people were like around the like late 80s, early 90s. Because we had the huge real estate boom in the 80s, right?
Yeah,
so it
yeah.
was right after that, like everybody was getting rich doing real estate. So everybody and their mother that made $10 million on real estate wrote a book and sold a online program. My parents must have bought three or four of those for sure. I remember them all going through it and being like, what do you guys know
that
about
still
real
exists.
Estate? Oh, yeah, no, it's like, definitely
it's big business.
Bro, this is how you know a market is about to drop is when all of a sudden you see all these courses on how to make money in that market. So that's when you know it's shit's about to crack.
Okay, so this is my
flip this house.
I 100% agree with that, and it's, you know, timing is everything in business. This is why I kind of, when people ask me now about the cannabis industry, I think it's too late. I think you're
the big players now.
And everybody thinks like, no, this, and I have a friend that, okay, well, cool. There's still always exceptions to the rule, and absolutely, there's still money
to
be made.
Now.
But it's way harder now, and it's, and the big, big companies are going to come in. It's those that are making decent money right now. It's short lived. Mm-hmm. You got to get on those things early when they're either sketchy or nobody wants to do them, and like, you got to believe, and that's the way the direction is going, not after everybody's made tens of millions of dollars and you've heard it fucking 10 times finally. Like, dude, everybody's done it now and made a bunch of money.
So I got to tell you guys what I did
with rebelalliance.net. You know what I'm saying?
Turn that into a porn site if you want.
How long did you keep the domains going?
For like a year, probably. Yeah. And then I was just like, oh my God, this is so stupid.
So I almost bought a bunch of domain names, and I tried to make them porn. Because I thought, well, porn is huge, so I'm not even going to mention the ones I came up with.
Yeah.
And I did own them for a second.
You know what? I know there's a stat. I would love to see the stat for how many business licenses were registered at City Hall and then never, ever made a dollar that year.
Oh, my gosh.
I think that's where a lot of the stats come from. That, like,
why do you think they want you to buy a fucking license?
Yeah, it's because it's just...
They're just making money
off of
nothing.
It's an easy hustle. $150 to $200, whatever it is now. To do that, it's just like everybody, their idea, they're like, oh, that's great idea.
It's a fucking racket.
Go down, that's the first thing I do. Go get a license. Like, go get my business license.
Now I gotta get a trademark, and then I get a patent.
No, you don't.
Oh, my God, it's $60,000 later.
No, you know what? And you start an online business, you don't get a business license. Where do you license it?
Yeah.
It's in the ether.
Right. You know what I mean? It's pretty funny I wonder how many of those, though, actually don't, like, with the percentages. I know it's pretty high, that how many people just register and never do anything about it.
So I gotta tell you guys what I did this weekend.
What did you do?
So
I saw you were at I saw you got to pick a beautiful steak, and you ate like incredible dinner somewhere.
Oh yeah, no, that's cool. That's not what I was going to talk about, but that's cool. Yeah, we ate at Alexander Steakhouse, which, have you guys eaten Alexander's?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh my god,
that's where you were at.
That's where I was at for the so it's super expensive.
This one right here downtown,
the one on Cupertino.
Oh, mm-hmm. We have one downtown.
So super expensive, but incredible food. The steak is just to die for. Appetizers, everything's amazing.
It's Kobe steak.
Great, right? Yeah, it's great restaurant, all that stuff, great. But that's not what I was going to talk about. I found a Russian-style spa.
Oh, my God.
That's co-ed, clothing optional.
You went?
Yes, I did.
You and the girl went?
We did.
And you guys nude?
Like, naked.
No
so,
way.
Yeah, so... It's in San Francisco, so I'm already like, huh?
Yeah.
So it's in San Francisco. It's called Archimedes Banya, I think was the name of it. So we go there, and my brother's been there. My brother's like, oh, it's fucking cool, dude. He's like, it's got, sauna, steam room, jacuzzi, cold dip. He's like, it's pretty awesome. So I go on their site, and their website's kind of crappy, so I'm a little bit like, I don't know. But it talks about what they have, and they have like this deck on the top where you can sunbathe naked, and it's clothing optional, right? And there's areas where you have to put on clothes, like if you go to the cafe or whatever. So I'm like, okay, so let's go check this out. So we drive up there, and it's not like a sketchy part of San Francisco, but it's not like a great part. So I'm already a little bit like, what's going to happen here? Well, yeah. And when you walk in, it's got an interesting feel, because there's like a front desk, and it's separate from everything else. And you know what it gives me the feel of when I walked in? You know when you go, remember like the old school cannabis clubs, when you walk in and you can tell the front desk is almost there to screen who's coming in and who's not? So my guard's up a little bit. Plus I'm with my girl. My girl's hot. So I'm like, okay, if I go in here and it's weird, we're going to take off, because I'm a little bit, right? So we go in there.
You guys are here for the gangbang.
Exactly.
Excellent.
So we go in there, and sure enough, we I told my girl, I'm like, do you want to wear bathing suits? Like, just to be, and she's like, no, fuck it, we'll just go naked. I'm like, all right. So we go in there, we walk around, and sure enough, because we got there early, there's like five dudes in there. There's nobody else. So five dudes,
all
right?
All dudes, yeah, of course.
Yeah, so it's all guys, and they're just kind of walking around naked, and nobody's really, and I'm kind of on guard. I'm already thinking like, are they staring at my girl?
On
like,
guard,
what's going on, right?
Naked.
But no, everybody was cool, and as we hung out there 40 minutes later or so, then women started popping up and coming in, and It's legit a fucking spa. That's
okay.
So, there was no weirdness, at least when I went.
Did you before you, because you knew you were gonna do this?
Yeah.
Did you take care of your business?
What do you mean?
Did you like line your shit up, dude?
Line up my stuff?
Yeah. Or were you just out there like fucking out
dress
of control?
Up the main. Yeah.
Where you weren't even lined up?
I keep myself.
What do you go with?
Relatively lined kind of up.
The triangle.
Relatively
yeah.
lined up.
Yeah, like I'm not.
The fuck does that mean?
I don't use like a number one and shave the fuck.
Yeah, I know, but you like a haircut. Like you don't shave your head bald, but I mean you get a haircut. Did you get a haircut before you went there?
Kinda, because it's always
like a month anyway. Like a month before?
I think like last week I did. You know what I mean? If I recall.
A little hedging.
Okay.
Yeah, so I was good, but
because I feel like if I'm gonna go do that, I'm gonna put my business out there all over the place. Like I'm gonna get a haircut.
Well, bro, it's a weird experience.
I'm gonna line my shit up before I go out there because I don't know.
First of all,
I'm gonna create the trail.
First of all, it's extremely freeing to just walk around naked around people. I don't know what it is about that, but it's just pretty cool. But number two, within a short period of time, within 30 minutes, you realize how not big of a deal it is. Like at first you're like, oh my God, dude, fucking that girl's, I just saw that girl's vagina. She's got her titties out. The dude's dick's hanging out. But about 30 minutes later, it's not really a big fucking deal. Like everybody's just whatever. Fat people, skinny people, fit people, young people.
Is it like this big, like steam, like room, or like what does it look like?
So you walk in, and then you go to your locker area. You change, come, and they give you a robe and they give you a towel. The areas that require clothing, you need to wear your robe. Everything else, you can just be buck ass naked. You need to sit on towels all the time, right? They don't want you sitting, you know, balls on stuff.
Yeah, you don't want things crawling. Anyway.
Exactly. Yeah. So you use the towel, sit down, but. So when you walk in, there's like a sauna. There's two saunas. One has different levels, so you can climb up to the top level, and it's hot as fuck in that one of the hottest saunas I've ever been in.
Climb up like you're going up ladders naked?
No. So it's like you can sit. There's benches at the bottom, and then there's another level, and then at the top there's a top level. And the top is the hottest. There's a cold dip, so it's just it's not nearly as nice as the place up
Refuge.
In the, no, Refuge is like super nice. This looks like it's been around for a little while. It's not bad, but it's not super nice. It's more of a run-of-the-mill kind of spa.
Now, knowing all that and that you've experienced, because I'm a huge fan of Refuge. That's like Katrina and I's spot for sure, because I haven't found anywhere that I like better. Would you go back to this place, or is it just like an experience you did?
Here's why I would go back. No, it's not because I'm like, oh my God, like Refuge is way better. I don't care if I'm, you know, I'd rather go to Refuge and wear a bathing suit.
Right.
Because the atmosphere.
To be just naked, to be naked.
But the reason why I would go back to this other place is the naked experience. Really, I'm telling you, dude, something about walking around naked with random people and nobody tripping. You know?
I've been to places like this, but in my experience.
You want to go, Justin?
Other than Vegas.
How are you, man?
So I've been to a few topless and nude pools, and the only places that I've, and spas like this where. The only place that I feel like there's been good-looking people that are actually naked is in Vegas. Otherwise, it's like...
So what do you mean? So this was a full-nude pool party?
Yeah.
Or was it full-nude?
Yeah, they have those in Vegas.
I thought it was just topless.
What? No, they have topless ones, too.
So you went to a full-nude one?
So I've been to full-nude beaches. I've been to pools. And every time I've been to one of these, they're always... Nobody you really want to look at.
Yeah, that's been my experience.
Yeah.
The beaches.
And of course, you're not there. I know someone's going, well, you're not there for that. You know, you're not there to be looking at other people naked. And I get it. It's supposed to be freeing.
I guarantee you people are there for that.
Yeah.
There's some people that are there.
Right. Well, yeah, right. And I don't know. It's like, it's still scenery.
So the people that were there were kind of average, but there were a lot of younger people. Like I saw quite a few people in their 20s and 30s.
Oh, wow.
And there were a couple people that looked like they work out.
So that
now we definitely stood out because we're like the fitness whatever, but it also wasn't super busy because we went right when they opened, which was like it was 10 a.m. on a Saturday or something like that we went. So
food there, you said there's a cafe there.
We didn't eat anything there. So here's what we did: we went in, we did the saunas, we did the steams, we did the cold dip a bunch of times. Then we went up to the very top, and then we sunbathed naked.
You did a cold dip completely naked.
Yeah, I did.
Wow. Did your shit like
shrinkage?
You know what? I don't know if it did or not.
Or did the penis pump help?
Yeah, that's right. No, I don't think it.
He countered that.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm gonna pump this shit before I go out there. Yeah.
No, you know what my fear would be going into one of these things. So you think to yourself, initially as a man, you're like, oh man, what if I get shrinkage because I'm in the water? No, reality is, you know what you really probably fear is, What if you get a boner? What if you get an erection? What if you see an attractive woman?
Well, the 17-year-old version of me would definitely be afraid of that.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, even think about this. You're with your girl. She's naked, so you get to see her naked. Then she's comfortable being naked around strangers and all that stuff. That might cause something to happen.
Were you worried about that?
Was I worried about it?
Yeah.
For a split second, I was like, what if that happens? Then what? Everybody knows I'm the pervert.
When did you realize that went away?
that wasn't going to happen?
Yeah.
I just was comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, because at first you're kind of awkward, but then it's like not a big deal. You know what my other fear was? My other fear was running into someone I knew. Because being naked around strangers is not a problem. If I walked in there and I'm nude and all of a sudden I see like, you know, fucking family member or friend or something.
Right, right. I don't
then
think
I'd be like, oh, that's I had that one time
I was at a strip club. I saw some guy I knew and I was like, ah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was awkward.
That has got to be awkward for
very
sure.
Awkward.
See, I don't know if I could go do that with you because we sit here all day long and look at each other and talk to each other on the radio. I don't think we could I don't think I could see you hang out with you naked.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to go with people I know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because I like to keep that a mystery.
Yeah, that would be. You know what I
mean? Because what's going to happen, here's what will happen. At the end of that trip, someone's going to have bragging rights, and I'd rather keep it a mystery.
This is,
you know what I mean? Because it's one thing to be with your buddy, and your buddy be like, I got a bigger dick than you. It's another thing for them to know that they have a bigger dick and say that.
I see. Because
then you're like, fuck, man.
You're right.
You know what I'm
better keep your cards to yourself then, sir.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. All right. You ready for the bird?
Yeah, bring on the bird.
Bring on the bird.
This Quah brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
I think we should let the audience know we have a guest producer here today.
Yeah.
Taylor.
The backup producer.
Valenzuela. Yeah. Well, I want to give a shout out to Doug. Doug actually went up to Seattle. His father passed away, so he went up there for the service and everything. So love goes out to Doug and his family.
Yep.
And now we got Taylor.
And a big thank you. I know that we've had quite a few people on the forum that reached out to him and sent their love. Appreciate that, you guys. You know, everyone knows that this place doesn't run without Doug, and he is our rock. And
he's
having him out right
backbone
now,
backbone for sure,
is tough. Taylor's subbing in though right now.
No pressure.
First question from Kionya Kana.
You're doing it wrong, Taylor.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. Read the question.
Kionya Kana.
What are your thoughts on active recovery days versus full rest days?
So, great question. We usually advocate for active recovery days. However, full rest days definitely have their place. So real quick, I'm going to kind of decipher between the two of them.
Yeah.
A full rest day is when you're literally do nothing. So I worked out hard yesterday. I just ran a marathon, you know, whatever. Today, I'm going to just put my feet up. I'm going to watch TV. Or I'm going to get a massage, or I'm just going to literally do nothing that has to do with fitness whatsoever. The benefit of that, or the way you would use those, is when you have seriously overreached, when you've really pushed yourself to a point where you need to do nothing.
Mentally and physically.
Yeah, that's going to benefit you more than anything to do nothing. And rarely do I advocate for full rest days, but I do, especially after competitions. Like, if there's like Melissa just competed, right, in her bikini competition, which shout out to her, she got second in the open. Great job. But for something like that, I'd be like, okay, don't exercise at all for a couple days at least. Or if you just did a marathon, or you just did
something super intense. Oh, you just had a football game. I used to do that Sundays. I mean, there was no way you're going to get me like up and about after like all that damage from the game. So,
right. Yeah. Active recovery is when you're doing something to facilitate recovery or to amplify an adaptation signal that you may have sent the day before. Now, I like active recovery days for the most part because you can do a lot of stuff on an active recovery day. So let's use Melissa as an example again. She just finished a competition. She could do a full rest day and that would be beneficial. An active recovery day might help her too, but it would be super low intensity. Stretching, you know, stretching could be that could be an active recovery day.
Yeah, I want to move away from her as an example because I think she's a bad example for this because she doesn't really work out 3 days going into that. And most of the stress that she's going through is nutritionally, and it's really 4 or 5
sure,
days before that.
Point.
So a better example is like what you guys were saying. Yeah, a marathon, a CrossFit competition, a kettlebell
Spartan
competition,
racer.
A football, OCR race, like something where you know you've pushed the boundaries, you know, beyond a daily workout. And it's, I think either a big competition like that or the compounding effect of multiple workouts of you overdoing it each time. Like, for example, if you beast moded it on Monday, Tuesday beast moded again, Wednesday beast mode, and you have these compounding days of hammering the body, mm-hmm. and you feel sore from head to toe, and in your head you think you're doing such a great job because you feel sore from head to toe, but in reality you're punishing the fuck out of your body and you're really not helping accelerate your results. So someone like that I might give an entire day off. But to be honest, I rarely ever, and I say rarely because I still do, but it's rare that I recommend to somebody a complete full day of don't do anything.
Laying on your back.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Because just promoting movement, I think, is ideal, even for someone who's really, really sore, because you're going to get the blood flowing. Even though you're not doing a traditional foundational day of working out or training, getting down and doing some mobility work and some stretching or yoga, I mean, that would be considered active recovery. And I would pretty much recommend that to anyone and everyone, because I feel like not enough people, it's really who we're talking to, right? Am I training to the 7 day a week person who's addicted to lifting every single day and they CrossFit or do something super high intensity? Or am I talking to average Jane or Joe, which is the other 80% of the population? If I'm talking to average Jane or Joe, I'm encouraging them to be in the gym every single day. And if you're not doing a foundational workout like for MAPS or your whatever program you're following, then I'm telling you to do some sort of active recovery, whether it's, you know, mobility focused, correctional focused, meditative focused. Like, I'm telling you to try and create some sort of, you know, movement that's beneficial to your body every single day. I think that's ideal. Now, the only other exception to that, in my opinion, is the small percentage of people that are constantly flirting with overtraining because they're always pushing for either competition or they love CrossFit or these types of workouts like Orange Theory that are mm-hmm. pressing the limits of your body on a day-to-day basis. Those people I could potentially see, hey, you know, and I've done this before where I've told someone to reset for a whole week. Like, hey, we need to just like, you've been hammering yourself. You've been in a low calorie deficit. You've been smashing the weights like crazy. Like, let's kind of let your body reset a little bit. But for the most part, I think active recovery is kind of where we all lean.
Yeah, and you know, when it comes to full rest days, the times that I recommend that really is to help with the mental component more than the physical.
Right.
You know, if someone's super burnt out and super negative about their training, or they're just feeling just mentally really fatigued, that's when I'll tell someone, hey, you know what? Take the day off. Don't do anything. Mm. Like, just do something you enjoy. Go watch a movie or something like that. From a physical component, because active recovery days are so moldable and I can individualize them so much, I can work around pretty much anything. And here's what you want to consider with an active recovery day. They will speed up recovery. It's not adding to...
Even if you get injured, you find that.
Yeah.
In therapy, they still want to be able to mobilize like joints that have the capacity to mobilize, because it, you know, it gets the proper circulation. It gets, you know, the healing process actually speeds up. Like
a study was just done on that. They actually just compared where somebody has an injury and the joint or the area was immobilized and left to rest versus active recovery or appropriate movement, and the movement
probably way faster
healed the body. Works so much better when you move it than when you don't move it. I give this example all the time. If you took two twins, all factors being identical, and you just beat the shit out of their legs with a super intense hard workout, and you took one and you told one of them, hey, listen, sit down, don't do anything, stay on the couch for the next 7 days, and then we're going to test you again. And you told the other guy, what we're going to do is trigger sessions and stretching and maybe a focus session here or there, and then we'll test you in 7 days. The person that was moving appropriately is going to have more strength and more muscle. They're going to improve much faster than the person just sitting there, because regardless of what stage you are in your training and what condition your body is in, except for extreme situations. But for the most part, regardless of where it's at, doing nothing makes your body adapt in a way that's detrimental.
Well, even then, like, too, like, just breathing and, like you said, like, meditation, like, these types of things that get you more in a parasympathetic state is so crucial, I mean, in the recovery process. So, like, maybe you do that subconsciously by just kind of relaxing and trying to relax, like, by watching TV and sitting down. But, I mean, you can do that just from, you know, focusing on your breathing and, you know, being more mindful, moving with that. So, you know, there's a lot of different things you can do on these, like, recovery days.
All of our programs, if you don't own our programs, or maybe you don't own all of them, this is the how MAPS is created. Like, the idea and the theory behind this of you have these foundational days that you train, regardless of what program you're in. We have our staple workouts, and then all the days that are not your staple workouts are these either mobility or their focus or their trigger sessions, which is feeding right into this question as far as active recovery is. We absolutely promote active recovery over full rest days.
I'll tell you what, it's a game changer. It's not a small thing. It is literally a game changer. If you take your workout, I don't care what workout you're doing. I don't care if you're doing a body part split, if you're doing MAPS, if you're doing whatever. I don't care. Take your whatever workout you're doing, and on your off days, utilize a trigger session concept. So what a trigger session is, which is in MAPS anabolic, is where you do 4 or 5 movements, preferably with bands, but you can do them with body weight or weights. Very low intensity for, you know, 4 or 5 body parts. Should take you maybe a grand total of 10 minutes. Squeeze the muscle, stretch the muscle, get a little bit of a pump, feel a little bit of a burn. You're not looking for any type of intensity. And do that several times on that during that day. So if it's an off day, let's say I don't work out on Tuesday, I'm doing 3 trigger sessions that day. Do them consistently, and it is a game changer. You'll notice as the day progresses, you'll get a better pump in the muscles. As the day progresses, you'll notice your muscles recovering more effectively. And then when you go back to your regular workout, you're going to notice faster results. It's that big of a game changer. This is why I talk about, because a lot of people will do, for example, MAPS Anabolic, since that's our foundational program. A lot of people will do that and they'll skip out on the trigger sessions, and they're going to get great results. The programming is great. It's all phased out. It's got great workouts for the foundational workouts. Everything's great. You're going to get great results. And then I'll get people who've done it 2 or 3 times through, and then they'll say, "But now I finally did the trigger sessions consistently. Totally different, like game changer." So I can't stress that enough. Especially if you're following a MAPS program, do not skimp out on those active recovery type days, whether it's trigger sessions, focus sessions, or mobility sessions. They are total game changers. If you're not doing a MAPS program, rather than doing a complete rest day, go to the gym. Or do it at home, go super easy, super light, and do active recovery on target muscles and watch what happens. I want to mention and talk about one of our sponsors, Thrive Market. I want to mention them because legit, I have been saving anywhere between $50 to $150 every single time I go shopping on their site. It's that big of a savings. And for the listeners who know me, they know that I buy organic products almost exclusively. Health is very important to me, and Thrive Market is full of that's all they sell is organic non-GMO based products, and the prices are anywhere between 25 to 50% lower than when you'll find a retail store.
What's the longest and what's the fastest something has come to you now as far as being shipped over? Like, because I know it's, what do they say, 1 to 2 days is what it's
typically? I get it in 24 hours.
Yeah.
Oh, I get it in 24 hours. Yeah.
Wow.
24 to 48 hours every single time.
Wow.
Yeah, it's very, very quick ship. And then here's the other thing that we haven't talked about much on the show that I really like. It's like, you know, I call it like, you know, conscious shopping, is that, you know, when you buy a membership with them, because you pay a one-time membership fee, which, by the way, if you use the Mind Pump code, you get a lot of, you basically get it for free. But before I get into that, if you pay for a membership fee, they will donate a membership to a low-income family, because the founder of Thrive Market, Gunner, he grew up very poor and he couldn't eat healthy because, you know, organic healthy foods are more expensive. And so what they do at Thrive Market is, for every membership that they have where someone pays for the membership, they'll give a free one to a family in need. So now you've got a low-income family, single-parent household, whatever, that now can shop at Thrive Market, save money, and get organic non-GMO stuff delivered to them. So it's fucking awesome.
But we waited a really long time to really partner up with some companies that we were excited about. And, you know, just real, Mind Pump was too small a year ago for a huge company like Thrive to come along and even offer to pay us anything. And, you know, we are now in a position to where we have that opportunity. And I know it's, I saw somebody on the forum, like, you know, talking about, you know, Mind Pump back in the days before we had advertising. And it's like, man, I wish everybody understood what it took to run a business that is this large and has this many people that we're contracting and working with. And, you know, it's not cheap to be able to put out all the content that we do for free all the time. And this is one of the ways that helps fund that, is be able to take sponsorships on. But one of the things that we all agreed on is we were going to run broke and tight until we found people
that we actually want to work with.
Yeah, that they
a legit message.
Yeah, exactly. It's not just it's not just an awesome product. It's not just fucking rad that you save more money shopping through them and they give you organic food. But the message that they have and what they're doing, 100% stand behind. Even if they didn't pay us money, this is the type of company that I would affiliate myself with.
They screen the companies that they carry for, you know, what they call fair, you know, labor. They want to make sure that everything is, you know, is environmentally friendly. They donate the memberships to families in need. Mm-hmm. It is one of the first companies that I can see that's really hitting all of these things and providing you with products at lower prices, which is, to me, it's crazy. It's like, how do you do both? Well, their model just fucking works. So what we do is you go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump and you'll get 30 days for free. You'll get $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and you'll get free shipping. So basically, you get a free membership and you get access to all these.
Right. And plus, you know, when you sign up for a membership, that somebody in need is getting hooked up with one also, which
that's
is cool.
It. That's it right there. Next question, Taylor. You got to pay attention.
Next question. Next question comes from Axe Handle 5606. Ollie lifting shoes, why are they so popular? Is everyone just lying to themselves about their ankle mobility?
Pretty much.
Excellent.
You know what?
Excellent observation.
I have a couple opinions on that. Because I remember the first time that you introduced me to lifting shoes. And why I liked them so much, and I still occasionally use them, was it allowed me to drop into a squat deeper than I'd ever been before and actually feel really comfortable and stable. Now, of course, I know now that the main reason why I was not able to do that was the lack of my ankle mobility, but it did help me in that direction. So I think the mistake that a lot of people are making with Ollie lifting shoes is lifting all the time with Ollie lifting shoes and not using it as a stepping stone to getting better ankle mobility. I mean, mind you, there's different people I'm communicating this to. If I'm talking to somebody who competes and they power lift or Olympic lift, then absolutely, because you can use that in a competition.
And you're competing with them. You got to learn how
to
use them.
Right. So there's an advantage to doing that. It's just like how we've talked about the weightlifting belt. If you're in a competition that allows you to use this tool,
it's exactly the same.
Right. It's a tool. Now, for the average lifters, which is there's this craze now, and this is what always happens, right? The professional power lifters and Ollie lifters and Olympic lifters, right? The guys that go to the Olympics for power lifting and shit. These guys are what everybody looks up to. We want to be like them, so we dress like them, right? Yeah. So we start wearing all the gear and the stuff that they're wearing.
So you're seeing like the spandex onesies and all that. Have you seen that? Like a lot of guys will just like, I'm going to squat today. They have to like wear this like spandex onesie. Yeah, they're singlet.
Right.
Like you do? And, you don't lift that much.
And it's it's not,
why the fuck are you wearing that?
It's not much different than, you know, going out and gearing yourself up the same way all the NFL players do before they go on the field just to go play some flag football with your buddies on the weekend. You know what I'm saying? It's just a little overkill for the average gym
goer.
You want
the uniform. Right. And I think that's what a lot of it, like the perception of it is like, well, all these people are using it, so they must be getting some kind of performance enhancement with this. Like it's a cool thing. It's a culture thing. So yeah, I could see like just a lot of people wanting to be cool and wear them, not really realizing, you know, what it's doing for their ankles and what they're actually, you know, getting the benefit wise, but also it's crutching, you know, what ankle mobility they did have
so
going into it.
This, and I remember before they became so popular, we used to see this in the gym a lot. I think you can see old videos of Arnold where they, you know, they'd be barefoot in the gym, but then they would put their heels up where they'd step on plates, right?
Yeah, either a plate or like a wooden plate.
We used to have actually like a 2x4 or something like that where we would just put our heels on it and we would teach depth of squat with
right.
that. That was like a teaching tool.
And so if you're just a normal gym goer and you're trying to put this together, like so what the Ollie lifting shoes does, because it's got an elevated heel, it's the same thing if you were to stand on plates or put a 2x4, like Justin's saying, underneath your heels. It doesn't require the knee now to have to travel way over the toes because your heels are elevated. So if you understand biomechanics, what's going on is you're now allowing the...
It just limits dorsiflexion.
Right.
Yeah.
Because now when I'm all the way down in a super deep squat, it's like if I was at 90 degrees as far as the angle of my shin to my foot. That angle is about the same now that I have the heel elevated. So it allows you to get into a deeper squat. But what we should really do is address the lack of ankle mobility that you have and work towards being able to barefoot squat if we can. And so now, like, I still keep my shoes. My shoes are in my bag. They travel with me wherever I go. And if it's a day that I'm going to be challenging myself PR-wise, which is rare, or I just want to see, like, it's been a while since I put that much weight on my back, I'm going to use it, like, as a precaution. Like, okay, I haven't put over 400 pounds on my back in a while. I don't want my ankles to be the limiting factor that makes me bail on this weight. So I might put my shoes on for that one occasion, and then I'll be in barefoot or in flat shoes the rest of the time.
I feel like they should be used more like training wheels, like you said. Like, I mean, it's something that, you know, you can get somebody to fit, like feel what it feels like to sit comfortably in a squat. Like, that's great. But or just like high level competition, because they allow it. So it's like, you know, that's one factor, like that one part of your body, the joint, that you don't have to really, train to succumb like this intensive force, this a lot of load on your back that's driving through your body. So, you know, like with the weight belt and everything, it just keeps you a little bit more secure there, so you can focus more on just, you know, the raw strength it's going to take to propel you back.
You're just taking out the weakest links. That's what all these tools are, is they're identifying your weakest links, using an outside crutch to support this weakest link, it's like wrist wraps or a belt, no different. You know why I like squat shoes? I'll tell you why I like squat shoes. When I debate someone on the importance of foot control, ankle control, and foot strength, and when people say to me it doesn't make that big of a deal, I say put on some squat shoes and see how you feel. And all of a sudden they're like, whoa, I could squat so much better. And it's like, okay, that's because we've artificially given you what you should be able to have without those things.
Right.
That's the thing. That's the one thing that I like about squat shoes is they can help forward that particular conversation. But if you have that weakest link in real life, if I'm walking around in real life, if I'm doing things in real life and I don't have squat shoes and a belt on and wrist wraps, and I go test myself, if I'm moving something that's heavier or whatever, I'm going to hurt myself.
Yeah.
I'm going to hurt myself.
You won't even be able to do it.
I won't be able to do it. And because my body, it's going to go to attempt to do this position or this move, and I don't have this support, and I'm going to end up injuring my back or my ankles or whatever. For the average lifter, I mean, I think it's a waste of money. I think if you're really into working out, it's fun to play with, and you're super into working out, then that's great. If you compete with them, of course, use them. Otherwise, there's really no... Do you guys see any...
It's cool to have. It's like... to me, it's like the belt. The belt and the shoes, to me, are like are really, really closely similar.
It's like
to
a uniform, really.
It is, and it's become that. Like, it's a trendy thing to do, like especially with like the belt right now. Like, you see all the men's physique competitors walking around with the belt on while they're doing cable exercises and stuff, which is absolutely ridiculous. And it's turned into kind of a fashion statement, right? So Ollie shoes have now turned into a fashion statement. They've, you know, Nike's done the Metcons, and you've got all the Reebok CrossFit shoes. So it's become, it's taken something that is a useful tool for powerlifting or Olympic lifting, and it's they've made it fashionable. So we can thank, you know, Nike, Reebok, companies like this. The science behind it is no different than what Arnold was doing back in the days when he's put his heels on a 2x4. So the understanding of biomechanics has been around forever, and we understand why that makes it easier for you to get down to a squat. But at the end of the day, you're crutching yourself. And the same thing goes for the belt. The belt, we want to be able to internally be able to flex and squeeze our core to support our spine. We don't want to have to use an external tool to do that. But if you are in a competition where they allow those tools and those tools do give you a slight edge, then it makes total sense why you would do that. It's like, listen, you're competing, you're trying to, and what's happened because we've this last like 5 or 10 years, we've become very PR hungry. Like trainer 15 years ago plus, I never even heard of, I didn't even know what a PR.
I know, that's CrossFit then,
like,
really.
PR didn't even exist. Yeah. It was, no one really talked about that. It's become such a crave now to be chasing this. And I get it. Like, you know, if we are hitting PRs, we're getting stronger, and more than likely we're building muscle. And so it's a great measure of that. But I think it's become so important and so ingrained into our fitness culture now that it's doing more harm than it is good. And I see
more. Cause big problems.
Right. It's causing injury. It's causing people to use all these tools just to reach PRs when it's like, really, I mean, if you're not functionally strong.
It's one of those things. It's like if you never used a weight belt before and you deadlift and the most you ever did was 400 pounds, and then you put one on, you learn how to use it. Now you did 415 or 420. You get to say, my PR went up by 20
you're
pounds.
You're reinforcing compensatory patterns. Like you're just perpetuating this problem that you have. So it's like, cool. You know, you're compensating. Like, cool story. Show me what you can do without all that shit.
Right, right. And I guess that's where it's, you know, to each their own, and it's different. It just depends on, you know, what that person's goals are. Maybe they are going to be competing one day, and so they want to get good at using those tools. But I think people should know, if you're an average gym goer, your goal should definitely not be to wear a belt, to not wear shoes, to not have to wear wrist wraps or any of those things. But it doesn't mean too that like you can't intermittently use them within your routine, because I understand that too. You'll see me pull my shoes out every once in a while. You'll see me pull out wrist wraps every once in a while. But you better believe that I'm getting my training in to make sure that I'm not losing mobility in my ankles. It's more for me as a day that I'm going to go hit a PR, and it's exactly for that reason. It's like I know I can probably squeeze out an extra 15, 20 pounds if I've got my belt and I've got my shoes on, for sure. And that's purely an ego-driven thing. I'm not going to build any more muscle that one day. It's so I could literally say, hey, I squatted 400-something pounds today. Hey, I deadlifted X amount of pounds today. So I think being aware of that is the step, right? That's the main thing, is like, if you're aware of that's how you're using it, it's okay. Don't get caught up in doing it because everybody else is doing it and this is something I should do on a regular basis.
All right, next question comes from Focus Fitness for Life. What are your thoughts on sexual fitness, such as through Jayama or Kim
Anami?
Anami.
So I looked those people up.
Thank God, because I have no idea.
I didn't know what they were either. So I looked them up.
Sexual fitness.
So these two people that they refer are.
I love how you pick questions that neither one of Justin.
Well, no. Well, like, the two people we don't know about.
Thrusting cardio.
I figured we could comment about sexual fitness because we're experts on everything.
Yeah.
So the two people they're like sexologists. These are like experts, self-proclaimed.
My favorite people.
So the first person, Jaya Ma, I looked her up, and I guess she talks a lot about the. What does she call them? The five archetypes of sexuality. You want to hear what they are?
Yes, yes, I do.
Very interesting. Actually, yes. This is very interesting. So these are the way that people are turned on, like the different types of people and how what gets them in the mood or whatever. Mm. So the first archetype is the energetic archetype. They're turned on by space, tease, and anticipation. Then there's the sensual one, who's turned on by comfort, relaxation, and all the senses being ignited. Then there's the sexual one, who's turned on by nudity and flat-out sexual intercourse. Then there's the kinky person, who's turned on by the taboo and power play. and then the shapeshifter, who can be turned on by all of the above.
I was just going to say
shapeshifter.
Yeah.
Yeah, self-proclaimed.
I'm turned on right now.
It's kind of like, so this is like, did she write a book? Is there a
book? Yeah, I guess she wrote a book on it, but it sounds fascinating, like, right?
This is like the love languages of sex then, right?
Kind of.
So, you know, the way
Well, let me ask you guys this. Does one of those resonate with you more than the other?
The last one.
The kinky?
No,
the shapeshifter.
It's the shifter, yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean,
what mold to the energy that's there, right?
You're basically always ready to rock and roll. How about your girls? Like, which one? Because I know women tend to be a little more specific, or at least that's the stereotype, right?
I think it's the one that's the comfort one. I think.
The sensual.
I find that one a lot. Yeah,
she has to relax.
Be like, you got to control the environment and everything. And
throw some nudity in front of my girl. She's good to go.
My girl's that's the same awesome. Way, bro.
No way.
It's easy.
That's right. All you gotta do is walk around.
It has to be all subtle. Like all this subtle stuff.
You have to be like a ninja.
Totally. I'm a professional now.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And then the other girl, what's her name? God, what is that girl's name?
Kim Anami.
Yeah, Kim Anami. Let me look her up again. So she does these exercises for her vagina.
Oh,
she,
I saw her.
Is this the Kegler?
Yeah, so look what she's hanging.
She hangs like weights onto her pussy.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so she puts...
We actually invited her on the show a long time ago.
So we did.
Yeah, like
she's
2 years ago.
Squeezing that to maintain reach out it to her. In there?
Well, so these pelvic floor muscles...
Taylor's rolling his eyes right now, but I'm telling you right now, dude, this would be a great guest.
I think so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So... These pelvic floor muscles are very important.
What a punk you feel like, Taylor, when she can curl more with her pussy than you can with your bicep.
She's doing
pussy curls like fucking more than you can bicep curl.
Well, so this is important. Actually, this is very important.
This is
very important to talk about because we have some female listeners who've had children and... Nobody talks about the pelvic floor muscles and how they become atrophy because of the childbirth process and having children. And then after having kids, all of a sudden, if they laugh or sneeze or run, they pee themselves. You guys trained a lot of...
It's like a hot dog in the hallway.
God. Thanks, Justin.
Yeah, hey. No.
You guys have had a lot of female clients?
I've actually had lots of women in their 50s plus that have had 3, 4 plus children.
And they can't run or
anything. And if I had... it was crazy. Yeah, if I had them do jumping jacks or jump boxes, they would literally pee themselves. And they would have to go to the restroom. And it was a very common thing that... Yeah. That would happen. So, this is very, very... I wish I knew what I know now, though, to, like, how to kind of educate them on how to take care of themselves so they don't have that issue. Because a lot of them... And I remember the first time I came across it, I was just like, oh, shit, like, is that normal? Mm-hmm. And then another one, and then another one, then I realized, like, oh, this is more common than I realized. And I wish, because I remember when it happened to me early on, the first client that was like this was in my early 20s, and I was just like, oh shit, she must just have an issue that I'm not familiar with. And it wasn't until I trained several clients later that have all been
very, very common.
Yeah, had multiple children in advanced age that have this condition, and it's for that exact reason. Now, what is obviously stringing a coconut from your vagina is the progression to this, and I don't recommend all women should string coconuts from their clitoris.
Pussy push, pussy pull.
But
it's not the clitoris, actually. Right. It goes
like,
in.
What's the actually, planned programming?
They actually. So what she does is she tells women to. I think she sells a device where you put it in and then you squeeze around it.
Like beads, like a bead or whatever.
Yeah, and then she can attach weight to it to get those muscles stronger. Wow. Those are very important muscles. They're also important, believe it or not, they do play a small role in core stabilization. So keeping those weak and then strengthening your core and doing other stuff, like you're missing a small piece. So one of the easiest way to exercise it is to literally... squeeze and lift, like you're sitting there and you're just trying to squeeze, like you're trying to stop yourself from urinating. That those are the muscles that do that, to squeeze and hold, to create tension there and to strengthen those. So that's what she talks a lot about. But the other woman's talking more about sexual fitness in terms of just, you know, working on that with your partner, or talking about those things, or, you know, your relationship with your partner and stuff like that.
Well,
you know, what's fascinating about this is when we think of, you know, when we think of health. When we think of total health, we tend to separate things into categories, right? Mm-hmm. Physical health, emotional health, mental health. Like, and if you're sick in one of those areas, you go see a specialist for that specific area. Like, I have anxiety.
They all work together.
Yeah. Not only are they all together, but it's the myth of separation The human organism is one. It's one thing. And if one piece of it is off, then the rest of the organism tries to adapt and change to compensate for that one thing that is off. And that includes your sexual health. Mm-hmm. If you're fit,
well, think about it, when you are physically healthy, right? When you're physically healthy, normally your sex drive is up and your sexual
hormones are balanced.
Right. Yeah. That's doing every one of your systems is benefiting from that. And when it's down, all of them are suffering, and some more than others. And we're all genetically a little different. Like some people, their fitness health, right, affects their mental, spiritual, and sexual health more than others. But absolutely, they're all connected and work together. And it's just a matter of how much it affects.
Yeah, I just remember, like, Paul Check, like, we kept, like, he kept reiterating, and their dick doesn't go up anymore, you know, and he just kept, like, reiterating that. And I'm just like, why is he hammering that so much? And it's just like, it's true, though. Like, when your body's out of whack and out of sync with all these different factors, like, it will, like, a lot of times, like that could affect your sexual performance, and all these things are related. So
it
why
can,
not talk about
but
it?
But we also think of sexual health as when other things are off, then your sexual health goes down. But if you don't exercise your sexual health, it can also influence the other stuff.
Absolutely.
So
sure.
if you're not having good sexual relations with another person or with yourself, or you're repressed in any particular way in those areas,
or inanimate
it
objects,
can, yeah, it can influence your physical health, your emotional health, and your mental health. It is a part of, it is a small piece of this large pie called the human organism, and it's important to consider all of this stuff. It's very, very important, and I love that I'm learning a lot about it now. I wish, look, you know, I'll tell you what, when it comes to sexual health, let's go back to when we were kids. Here was an area that was sorely lacking in my upbringing. We didn't talk about sex at all. And it definitely impacted my sexual health as an adult, to where I had to erase a lot of stuff that I had thought. I had to kind of develop my own, you know, thoughts around it as an adult, because as a kid, it was so taboo. We didn't talk about it. Nobody talked about it. So now as a parent with my kids, and I know it's an important piece of being healthy. I mean, I had this conversation with my, you know, with my son, because now he's in the, you know, he's doing the sex ed, and we're going to talk about things like masturbation and health and why it's good for you and why these things are not bad and whatever. Like, it's all a piece of it, and it's very, very important. I would love to have a sex expert on the show.
Well, I would too. Mm. Can you think of some things that you guys apply right now, like in terms of sexual fitness, to make sure that that part of your life stays healthy? Like, you, the same way that we talk about our exercise and making sure that our body stays healthy, because we train it, we build muscle, we burn body fat, we live in a, you know, caloric deficit for half the time and then a surplus in the other, and we rotate our food. We do all these things for our internal health and fitness and our body externally. What are you guys doing to keep your sexual fitness alive and with your partners? Are there things that you have implemented into your lifestyle, or is that an area that maybe neglected that you guys don't talk and spend a lot of time on?
So at the moment, it's not something that I need to place focus on, because we're so connected on that level, that the sexual fitness between me and my girlfriend is so good, because we're so open. We talk, you know, about whatever we want. We're so connected. We make time for each other. But in the past, you know, in my marriage, it was, especially towards the, you know, the end there, it was absolutely terrible. And some things I think would have helped would have been to maybe, you know, and this is obviously hindsight's 20/20, so I can look back and think, oh, this would have totally helped. At the moment, I would have never thought of this, but I wish we had scheduled time to just lay down, cuddle, and talk with no expectations. Because I think with, especially at the time with my ex, she made it felt like, oh, if we're going to do that, there's pressure to have sex. So then she's going to be like, that's going to add anxiety and stress to the whole situation, because she's so stressed out. Mm-hmm. You know, she was a very stressed out individual with life and everything. So that might have been something that would have been beneficial, where I said, hey, look, why don't we schedule this time? We're just going to lay down, cuddle, and talk, and there's no expectations. And I'll place the ball in your court, and I'm not going to be disappointed or whatever if nothing happens. And that could have contributed, I think, in a positive way.
Yeah, I think it, I mean, this is something that we've addressed multiple times, and just after having kids and like the change of chemistry and the way that, you know, the perception of sex and kind of my expectations and all that kind of stuff, we went through like different like highs and lows with that, and like maintained like really good communication throughout the process, which definitely helped to get us back kind of more in a place where we realized, I mean, going through that whole process, like the body's changed. The body's changed. The hormones have changed, like all this stuff. And like now kind of getting back to making ourselves, both our, ourselves more healthy as far as stress levels, as far as like, you know, like thyroid, these things that we're finding that, you know, we could improve holistically. Then, you know, just naturally, like it just tends to just happen. Like you get these feelings again, and like the connectivity becomes, you know, deeper again. And it's interesting because like, yeah, for me, obviously it's like, I don't want to put the expectation, like, you know, like her perception was different because it's like, I'm more the aggressor, right? I'm out there to like, you know, like, I'm like, yeah, like my form of love is very physical, you know? And so I had to kind of check myself on that and be like, look, you know, let's create a different environment. Let's not be so like, you know, have this like energy about me, like walking in and like stressing her the hell out with, you know, all my like crazy energy. And, so I had to like really work on that and figure that out. And, it's really helped. And this is something that like, now we're kind of in a place where I understand kind of the sequence, the cadence, like what, you know, I need to do like contribution wise at the house, you know, how I need to offload a lot of stress, you know, that's weighing her down, like all these different things. Like it's a, you know, it's a communication, it's a push pull, and it's getting better and better. So it's just, that's all part of it.
Number one killer for sexual health is stress.
Yeah.
I mean, stress will just, it'll kill me 100%. If I'm stressed out, like that's the last thing on my mind. And it's like, if I handle my stress, then it's not a big deal. Everything's cool.
Is there things that you guys do though to make sure of that? Like I'm sure the last year that we've had all this stuff going on, has there been things that you guys have seen that has stressed the relationship that you're now more aware of? And so you've put things into practice like, hey, when this happens, we need to do this, or, you know, or are there things too that maybe make your guys' ladies insecure or jealous or frustrated with you with something like that, and so you know how to combat that so it doesn't affect your guys' sexual relationship?
Conversation is the best for us. It definitely for me. So if I'm stressed out, if I'm really, really stressed out, if I can talk about it, that usually will lead to arousal for me for whatever reason. Like as I'm talking about the stress and I'm relieving it, it's like this release. And now I'm feeling really good, and then it turns into sexual energy many, many, many times. If I don't talk about it with the other person, then it just stays there. Mm-hmm. So conversation is so important, and we do that. I'm happy to say that most nights we spend at least 30 minutes to an hour where we just talk. Everything's off, and we're just having great conversation.
Mm-hmm. Do you have to prime that at all? Is there any priming to that, or do you just naturally just kind of flow into that?
It's like a routine for us. Like we do it at night, night before bed.
Yeah, and on top of that, like I think, you know, understanding how we're spending our time, you know, after like the kids go to sleep, it's like we get this little window, and like a lot of times it gets interrupted because during the week she'll work. And works from like 2 till midnight or whatever. And so it's like, okay, there's like 2 or 3 times a week I don't even see her. And so just to now, like the new schedule kind of forced us to, you know, shut down TV, shut down these, and we just sit there and like either some music's on or whatever, but we're like, I'm literally just engaging in conversation and trying to focus completely on, you know, what she has to say and what, you know, the conversation itself. Definitely you could feel like that connectivity coming back, and that definitely feeds back into, you know, sex and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, you go to the naked spa. That's great for that. It just is. It's really good for that if you go with your significant
other.
It's all
the old men, let's be honest.
It has nothing more to do than just, it's like you just feel like, what's the word? the taboo is gone of walking around that way or whatever and being around other people, and then all of a sudden you just feel alive.
Well, I think that has to do with you completely letting your guard down, since if we look at the evolution of man and clothes and why we started to clothe ourselves, like that's all insecurity driven, and that it's marketed to us that we need to wear these things, and that we keep up every week is a new fashion and
it's,
a new thing.
It's funny too, because if you look up like hunter-gatherers, modern hunter-gatherers, even those that live in really hot climates, people walk around naked for the most part, but the men always cover their men's genitalia is almost always covered. It's not common.
Bug bites.
It's not common to walk around with your dick hanging around, hanging out. And the reason is because it is such a visible. It's such a visible sign of arousal when a man gets aroused that it makes sense that they would want to cover that. You know what I'm saying? Could you imagine the? I could just imagine the trouble that would cause if you're with your.
It's a lot of sword fighting.
Yeah. You know, maybe. Yeah. Next question. Yeah.
Okay. Last question comes from Dennis Wayne. If you guys had the choice to be on a reality TV show, which one would you choose?
God.
Reality TV.
You know, it would be great if Adam was single. And that's not the great part because I love Katrina. But let's say he was single if he was on The Bachelor.
Yeah. Seduction Island.
Oh, my God, bro. That would be so great.
What was that one? Temptation Island.
We already had our buddy who's been on that. Ben Zorn. Did that. I don't know. After talking to him, I don't know if I would ever do a reality TV show.
It feels like it's a one-way street to 15 minutes of fame and then you're done. It feels like, right?
Yeah, no. I remember running into, what's his face from Jersey Shore? Who's the loud one?
Paulie. Was it Paulie?
Yeah, or not Paulie, the other one.
Mike?
Mike. Yeah, Situation. Thank you.
Situation.
Just fucked up. I mean, he was on all kinds of drugs.
What? Where was this?
In Vegas. He was coming. He was actually getting thrown out of the club. And I believe it was Hakkasan I was on my way into. And they were dragging him out. And you could just, I mean, he just looked just messed up. Like, really, really bad. And I feel like that's what happens to a lot of these, like, reality stars. Because before that, like, you weren't, like, a real actor. It wasn't, like, something you were pursuing, you know, a career into, like, acting. And you're really passionate about it.
You're just, like,
it.
A professional partier.
Well, what you normally what happens is, you know, whoever's creating this reality show has this characters that they're looking for. Right. And when you start like a, you know, Jersey Shore with that, like they looked for guys and girls that were going to fit this show. Right. Fit
and then
this
they
mold.
Feed it to them. Sure.
Right. Exactly. And then they put them in situations that are going to feed the drama and they create that. And I would never want to be a part of that. Like, you could not pay me enough, I think, to do. I take that back. Everyone has a number.
Well, and it's not real.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
Yeah. If you paid me fuck you money to do, which no one does, the whole point of reality TV shows and why they're such a moneymaker is because you can get away with paying somebody hardly anything because they want to be.
Or free.
Yeah, right. No, exactly. Because they want to be famous so bad that you can get away with paying them nothing to pretty much get on a show and act a fool of themselves. So I have never, and I've dated girls that had this desire to be celebrity so bad. I've never been starstruck. I've never cared about that. I'd much rather be the guy who's worth millions of dollars and you have no idea who I am than the guy who's not worth very much money, but everybody knows who I am because I'm Mr. Popular and all that.
What
place.
About, I mean, so if you actually have talent and you actually have goals in business, just like you started your Instagram account, right? And you actually are business-minded about it. I feel like there's a way that if you orchestrate that ahead of time and like you're actually known for like what you're going in it with, you might have a chance. I mean, that might be something.
No, I think you're right. If you have some, let's use Ben for that example, right? And I think Ben even went on this most recent one again with that same attitude. And what we've seen is it's not translating into dollars for him whatsoever. And so I think you got to ask yourself that if you go into a reality show, you're at the mercy of the guy who's the director.
Producer.
Yeah, the producer and the director. Mm-hmm. So if I have my own agenda that, hey, I'm going to build this fitness company and I'm going to go on this new fitness reality show that's out there. Mm-hmm. And then I find out they've scripted me to basically be the guy who fucks all the girls on the show and creates drama and I'm getting shit thrown at me all the time. Like, yeah. Is that going to pivot to my fitness dreams that I was really trying to do? Or am I going to become the douchebag on TV who fucks all the girls?
You say that. Yeah. Cause I mean, look at Biggest Loser and like America's Toughest Trainer or whatever. It's just like, that's pure marketing. Like the director and whoever just like kind of created this persona mm-hmm. of like these trainers, and they got their own celebrity with it. Some ran with it. Some, you know, that's were burned by it.
That's a good example, because I think Jillian Michaels, if it wasn't for Biggest Loser, I think she's a terrible trainer. You know, let's be honest.
I mean, you said it.
Say it. Yeah. And I know she has a podcast.
I'll back it,
right?
Know
no,
saying?
She's yeah. sorry. You know what I'm saying? They're...
You know what's funny is she's actually... I've seen some stuff that she's written recently. It looks like she's starting to get better. Because in the early days...
I would hope so. She's now been a trainer for God knows how many years. But I know when they first put her on Biggest Loser, I definitely know her...
She was a character.
Yeah, her experience, her education.
Well, she's a brand now. I mean, she's on like everything. Like,
right.
She's put her face on it.
So it definitely worked out to her benefit for
sure. It's got to work if you want to turn it into a business. But, because like The Bachelor, like you're on The Bachelor. What can you do with that now, business-wise? Nothing. What can you do? Maybe
you could write a book on relationships.
Maybe, yeah, something like it would have to translate, like, mm-hmm. or maybe sell like clothing or makeup. I know a lot of these female reality stars then will sell makeup and they'll do okay. And you got to be really good at what you're doing. But here's the thing you got to consider: you get typecast with regular shows. So if you play Superman on a TV show and that's what you do, then you tend to get typecast. With reality shows, the typecast is even worse because people assume that's who you are.
Right.
Yeah.
So now you're the fucking douchebag party guy, or you're the girl
and
that
they,
whatever.
100%. If you yep. if
and that's
people,
in real life, you try and get a job or anything.
If people are not aware of this, like, they fully script even reality shows. Reality shows are not just turn the cameras on and let people do what they want to do.
Ben was telling me, like, even on one of the, like, so the first meeting, like, everybody's there, have this big, like, dinner, all this stuff, they're filming it, and they're getting reactions. They literally had to, like, the next day, wear the same exact thing.
Do it all over again.
Do the same exact thing all because they didn't get enough shots.
Right.
So they had to recreate that entire thing all over again.
Yeah, and then they cut and edit.
Yeah.
So you can easily, I mean, God, think of all the things I've said on the show. You could easily take little one sentences out of a whole paragraph of something I'm talking about and really make me look like a piece of shit because you didn't let me finish my sentence. Well, they do that in reality shows they prod them, they stick them in situations, they take out pieces that are going to shape the character that they're trying to create, and it's a fucking... you can never catch me.
Here's my answer to this. If I had the choice to be on a reality show, I would be on my reality show. That's the one I would choose. And I'll tell you...
That's not a real show.
That's the stupidest answer I ever heard.
Let's get a real show after this. After this answer,
why don't you let me finish?
I know. Go ahead.
Let me make my own rules up here.
You gorilla.
Ed TV, right? Wasn't that the?
It's my
show. The Truman Show.
Hey, it's our fucking podcast. I can make up my own rules. No, I'll tell you. It's a reality
show.
I would do a reality show,
and I'm in charge. I produce it. I direct it.
Listen, it's phenomenal. What does Trump say for long? Whatever. Here's what I would do. I would do a reality show where we go into gyms and we fucking turn them around in a month. That would be a great reality show.
Gym Rescue or something.
And it would only bolster our authority and our space. It would only show what we can do. And
you know,
I think it would be compelling.
That would be fun.
Think about that. We walk into a gym and we take over.
We've discussed this, right? And here's the problem with it. And part of the reason why I think we haven't fully pursued it is... Once you go down that, it's a fucking rabbit hole, right? It's inevitable. Even if like the first four or five shows, everyone's like, oh, this is really cool. And after four or five shows, it's over. It's the same thing. It's not cool anymore. To us, it's cool because we're going in, we're flipping gyms, and it's what we love to do, and yet it is. But for entertainment purposes, it's dead. Unless... We're creating false drama.
Yeah, drama.
Where
somebody's
we
throwing
go,
up.
Right, we go in to flip the gym and we find out the general manager is fucking all the trainers. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. And we have to go in and
we
have to
make
like,
it way spicy.
Right. If it's not soap opera like, it won't feed the loop.
Well, let me ask you this. If we walked into 10 gyms that need to be turned around, do we really need to create drama? I think it's there. Come on, we've worked in enough gyms.
Okay, again, so you're right.
America says yes.
It is there.
All gyms, bro.
It is there, but after we go and flip one gym and we put everybody's fucking business on Front Street, what gym's going to let us in the next time to go do that to them?
Like, I don't know. The restaurants do it with the restaurant takeover.
Yeah, but see, that's the same thing, though. That's all orchestrated.
Right.
Ahead of time.
Right.
Yeah. So they make it, like, extra dirty. They add all these, like, bugs and shit. Like, I know. I remember talking to somebody that was, like, attached to that.
Here's the deal. Your idea of it being you would be a bad reality producer. You just wouldn't know how to do it.
It's too real. It's boring.
You and everyone close to you would think your show is cool because it's about you, and it just feeds that narcissism.
Other people think.
Here's one. Cool. I would like to be on the Sharks. Yeah. That would be fun. Just to get in front of
Shark Tank. Cuban.
Yeah. And I know the same thing with that. That's all orchestrated. They hand select all these people. You know, they reach out to them and they make sure they give them a script and everything to follow.
Dude, I remember watching American Idol, which is a brilliant, by the way, one of the most brilliant, shows ever, because they knew that they would sell records for whoever won because you followed them on their journey. But I watch it, and then they'd have these shitty singers go in front of, you know, Paul Abdul and Simon and, you know, whatever. And for a split second, I remember thinking, like, oh, man, those people really suck. This is terrible. And then I'm like, wait a minute. Like, thousands of people are waiting to get in line. They can't see everybody. And I'm like, oh, they're purposely picking shitty people.
Yeah.
Like, they're purposely like, oh, you should go.
Yeah, they need contrast.
In front of the judges. And they're like,
right.
Yeah.
Right. It's not the 30 best singers of the 300,000 they met. It's about 15.
They want the
story. It's about 10 or 15 that they already know are going to be the final 10.
Yeah.
And then the rest are fillers for drama are going to be made fun of, and they're going to be hilarious or have an attitude or do something crazy.
Dang.
Yeah, I know.
Is there a reality show that you would be on if you had to pick one?
There isn't.
Absolutely had to pick
one? I don't. I 16 and Pregnant.
Oh, my God.
Don't do it.
You're out. Sorry, you're aged out of that one.
Oh, yeah. So, we hope so.
Yeah. No. That's the only one that I remember I tell you I watch when I'm sick, but there's no reality show. I never wanted to be on one, and maybe it was because we were part of the generation of these,
Real World on MTV. That was the first one.
Right. So
Puck.
This is,
remember Puck?
Right. So, I mean, technically, if you're being technical, the first true reality show is Cops. But moving beyond that would be Real World, Road Rules.
What are you
going
to do?
Yeah, right. Go in that direction. So we were part of the generation that saw this, and I got sucked into them as a kid. Like, I watched The Real World when I was a kid, but I never was like, oh, I would love to be on one.
It doesn't make sense to me to have.
I'm not attracted to drama.
Did you see now they have, like, The Real World, but, like, they have to, like, have 90s technology and, like, oh, my God, what can we do?
Oh, no.
Like, they take away their phones, no social media, and, like, these people are just, like. I saw a commercial for it, and I was just like, what the hell is this?
Oh, wow. Bro. No, yeah. I have not checked out what those are like, brother. Now.
I like Naked and Afraid.
Yeah.
That one's pretty.
I don't even know what that is.
So they
Naked and Afraid's great.
Bro, they take two people and they'll drop them in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, the bumfuck.
Naked.
Yeah.
They have no clothes on them, and they have, like, minimal things that they can work with. I don't, like, they'll give them, like.
They get to pick, like, one item.
Like, one item.
Yeah.
But, I mean. It's harsh, bro.
So it's like a knife or underwear. What do I want?
Yeah, right.
Fuck knife.
It's harsh. Yeah. They have to build their own structures.
So this is have you guys seen Alone?
Mm-hmm.
So Alone is like that. That's
the more hardcore version. That's like the more real version.
Yeah, that's super hardcore.
This is all
staged. It's like Man versus Wild, but it's competitive, right? So they drop 10 people on some remote island.
And what's
somewhere.
The prize?
I don't even remember. I think they win $1 million.
Oh, well, that's not bad.
Yeah,
that's not bad. Yeah, I don't understand people that want fame. Without money, or do you know what I mean? That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Fame without success. Like,
what's crazy
that.
Is more people than you think. It's extremely.
It's all ego and it's stupid. It's not what you want.
It's what we see. I mean, you know, it's no different than watching what I watch on Instagram all the time, which fascinates me. These people that will promote somebody else's brand. You know, knowing damn well they're probably not going to make hardly any money, but it's just to say that they're attached to this brand. And get some free t-shirts or free supplements. And it's such a win for the companies. And it's the dumbest thing you can do. And I know I'm probably offending quite a few people that are listening to this right now that do that. It's like, what are you doing? Like, if you care about building yourself or building your own brand or making a legitimate business, you tying yourself to a company and making 10% or 20% commission or some free supplements.
Bottles that you sell
it's like, but people want to attach themselves to this brand to say that they're a sponsored athlete. And it's beautiful because the companies play right into that. And they do that. It's the same thing with these reality shows. So many kids want to be, get their 15 minutes of fame that these brilliant companies are like, this is great. Let's find six dysfunctional kids that want to be on shows so bad that all we have to do is pay them $10,000 that we normally have to pay $10 million for actors to actually do this same ridiculous thing. And more people will tune in because they'll be idiots.
Go to Mind Pump TV on YouTube. We post new videos every single day. You got to see the one that's up right now with Justin. It's pretty hilarious.
I'm half naked.
Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, we got 30 days of coaching. It's available for free.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.